Star Trek envisioned a high-tech future of starships and space stations. And more than ever, our real technology is reaching for the stars to realize some of that sci-fi future. But some of the most ambitious programs actually rely on technology that's been around for hundreds of years, like the innovative 19th century optics from Lighthouses that could help take us to the moon and beyond. Star Trek's series Deep Space Nine aired in the 90s and portrayed life onboard a huge space station in the 24th century. So maybe NASA was going for a very early start on that when they launched their Deep Space One mission in 1998. The mission was a technology demonstration that spent more than 3 years in space visiting an asteroid and a comet while it tested out a slew of brand new methods for the next generation of space exploration. Notably, it was the first spacecraft to be powered by an ion engine rather than traditional rocket fuel. Normally, spacecraft burn fuel to push themselves around in space, but that means that you'd have to take all the fuel that you'd need for a long journey, which is heavy, so it requires more fuel, and you can see where this goes. So Deep Space One tried out a new type of engine that used ions instead of conventional exhaust gases. The idea is that small quantities of xenon gas could be electrically charged and then accelerated by an electric field. The individual ions would be ejected from the spacecraft at speeds of up to 144,000 kilometers per hour. In the test flight, that was enough to accelerate DS-1 by up to 4.3 kilometers per second. The engineers think they could have gone even faster, but there was more to DS-1's mission than just going super fast. Nonetheless, ion drives were a breakthrough in spacecraft propulsion, especially for long distance or long duration missions, as only tiny quantities of xenon are needed. But to make DS-1's enterprising ion engine work, the spacecraft needed a very strong and reliable source of power, and that is where the 200-year-old lighthouse tech comes in. In the mid-19th century, French engineer augustin-jean Fresnel figured out a way to use lenses to make lighthouses more effective. A lens could theoretically bend and collect the lighthouse's light and make it visible from farther away, but a convex glass lens big enough to do that job would have been far too heavy to mount at the top of a tower. Fresnel figured out that you didn't need a big, thick lens to get the same bending of the light, just its outer curved profile. So he effectively hollowed it out and then flattened the once curved surface into a series of concentric circular prisms. The light passes through and is bent pretty much exactly as it would be with a thick, curved lens, but with just a fraction of the materials and weight. So these Fresnel lenses were used in lighthouses to collimate the light, to take the diverging light rays from a lamp and straighten them out into one concentrated beam. Collimating. Make it into a column, I guess. This was a huge victory for maritime safety and navigation, but over the years, Fresnel lenses also found other applications. They can be used as lightweight, slimline magnifying sheets, and if they're turned around, they can focus the incoming light down to a point, which proved to be just the thing to supercharge DS-1's ion engines. Because the spacecraft also sported brand new so-called multi-junction solar panels. Made of different materials layered together, they were able to absorb more of the sun's wavelengths than traditional silicon photovoltaic cells. In fact, they can theoretically produce the same wattage with just 1/8 as much surface area. But to get the most out of them, these revolutionary new cells needed to have a high intensity of light falling onto them. So engineers turned to Fresnel lenses to design what they called a solar concentrator with refractive linear element technology, or SCARLET for short. SCARLET was a component that sat above the multi-junction cells with the sole purpose of concentrating the sun's light. NASA scientists made the already slimline lenses even more lightweight to reduce the cost of launching them into space. And they curved an extended sheet of Fresnel lenses so that even more light could be focused on a single point. DS-1 ended up using 720 of these lenses to focus light onto 3,600 solar cells. That was enough to generate about 2,500 watts of continuous power, which is about the same as 3 microwave ovens. That might not sound like much, but it's more than most solar system probes run on. It was enough to power DS-1's instruments and its groundbreaking ion engines. So it was thanks to these 200-year-old lenses that DS-1's advanced technology mission was considered a resounding success. The Fresnel-enhanced solar cells were a revolution in space power, but back on Earth, it soon became much cheaper to make normal silicon photovoltaic cells, so for most applications, the traditional variety are used rather than solar concentrators. But the high-efficiency cells are still being considered for larger-scale projects like solar power plants in sunny places like Arizona and Colorado. In space, however, SCARLET's Fresnel lenses and DS-1 did demonstrate the viability of a new kind of propulsion only using solar electricity and a few high-speed ions. And these ion engines are now widely used for positioning satellites in Earth's orbit. And also, they are planned to propel the Gateway's support mission to the moon in preparation for the future Artemis program of manned lunar missions. And who knows, they may even have a use on a space station 300 years in the future, named Deep Space Nine. However, in the meantime, if you would like to experience experience Deep Space One up close and personal, you can, because it is this month's pin of the month. From the time this episode goes up through the end of February, you can order this Deep Space One pin for your very own. We'll take pre-orders through the end of the month, and then we will ship, and then we will never make that pin again. Never fear, though, we will make another one in March, so look forward to the next one and check out the link in the description to learn more.